So this is just to give you a hint about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. And you see that this, when Allah says, Hal tara min futur, do you see, look at the sky, your eyes will come back. In the next ayah, He repeats it. ثُمَّ رَجَيْ الْبَصَرَ كَرَّتَيْنِ يَنْقَلِبْ إِلَيْكَ الْبَصَرْ خَاسِيًا وَهُوَ حَسِيرٌ. That then look again, and yet again your sight will return to you in a state of humiliation and worn out. You will not be able to find any flaw in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking here about intelligent design. You know, when we create buildings, when we create a roof over our heads, even if it's a brand new building, after a few months, after a few years, it develops cracks. Even if you use the best architects, after a while, it gets rusty, it gets cracked, it gets, something happens. It's never perfect. It becomes old with age. But the sky that Allah has created, subhanAllah, it has been there for millions of years. No cracks. It's a sky that changes its colors all the time. Sometimes it's cloudy, sometimes it's blue, sometimes it's slightly a tinge of pink, sometimes a tinge of purple. It's all there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, look at it, and again and again and again, your eyes will come back in humiliation because you will not be able to find even a single flaw in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's how perfect Allah is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is free of all faults. So this is also mentioning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created things in perfection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created things in the finished form. And this is kind of like a reply to the evolutionists. Those people who believe in evolution and that, you know, things are evolving. You ask them to give you one example of something that's evolving right now. Because they say, you know, we used to be like monkeys and then this. How come we are still here and the monkeys are still here? How come there is not a creature on this face of this earth which is like a half man, half monkey? Confused. How come there is not some weird alligator fish that's half in the water, half trying to get out? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the ostrich, it's complete. The elephant, it's complete. The rhino, it's complete. The alligator, complete. The apples, the bananas, the peaches, complete. The trees, the mountains, everything, complete. Everything is right there. There is not even one example, not even one, of a half link. Something that's stuck between evolutionary stages. Not even one example. SubhanAllah, and even their own professors now admit that, you know, this is a bunch of hocus pocus, you know, nonsense basically. We don't have much evidence behind it. It was just a theory that we stated. Just to trying to rebut intelligent design. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives logical proof of the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists. He's asking you to look again and again at the design of the designer. You know, Plato and Aristotle, the great philosophers, would say that wherever there is a design, there is a designer. And this is something that is even a child can understand. If, for example, you see the kurta that I'm wearing, it's designer, mashallah. Alhamdulillah. And maybe when you were coming in, you might have seen a peacock outside. Did anybody see a peacock? Okay, alhamdulillah, some people saw it. Who saw it? Raise your hands. Some people saw it. Okay, alhamdulillah. So try on your way out to see the peacock. Maybe it's still roaming around somewhere. So the peacock, look at the feathers. When the peacock opens the feathers, right? So you look at my shirt. It's very nice, mashallah. But then you look at the peacock also. Tell me, which has a more complicated design? My shirt or the peacock's feathers? The peacock's feather. This shirt was made by a designer. But the feathers of the peacock were, subhanAllah, not made by a designer. Yes? No, of course not. So this is what these philosophers were saying. Now when you look at the design, you marvel at the designer. You marvel at the designer. Here's a book right here. If I was to tell you that this book, it came from nowhere. Automatically from the sky fell orange and red ink and black ink and pages fell from the sky and then black ink fell and it just automatically put itself out like this in a sequence, and then diagrams were formed and pictures were formed inside the book, and subhanAllah, the book was completed without any interaction or human intervention or anything like this. It just happened. Would you believe that? I think an absolute lunatic would believe that, that this came by chance, that this happened as a result of nothing. SubhanAllah, you know, our own human DNA, they call it the book of life. They call it the book of life. And the reason why they actually call it the book of life is because it is a very, very complicated book. They say that the one single gram of DNA, it contains 700 terabytes of information. And if you were to take 2 grams of DNA, it would fit the entire digital information of this planet onto 2 grams of DNA. that you have in your body right now. All of the digital information can be put into 2 grams of DNA. And they say if you were to take the DNA molecule and line them up one next to the other, they would go up till Pluto and back from the planet Earth. That's how much information is contained within each and every single one of you. About the color of your eyes, about your behavior patterns, about your hair, about your speech, about every single aspect about you that makes you a human being and that gives you the certain qualities that you have. All of that information is inside of you. Like the chimpanzee has a DNA. Even the banana has a DNA. They say that the chimpanzee's DNA is like 95% like ours. But the DNA of a banana is 50% like ours. So are we all half bananas? I don't think so. And you know that each and every single one of us, if we were to compare our DNAs, they would be 99.9% similar. All of our DNAs right now, although we might be very different from different backgrounds, Jat, Bhat, Chaudhary, Gujjar, Arai, I don't know what else. Rajas as well, obviously. So, but the thing is, our DNAs are 99.9% the same. But yet even a slight change in the DNA can actually end up into a different species. And so, subhanAllah, this is how much information is contained. So, this book was created by someone, but the book of life that is inside of me, subhanAllah, it was made of chance. That is the biggest bunch of nonsense I've ever heard in my life. It's the biggest nonsense. It's hard to believe how a person can actually believe such a thing. That something came out of nothing or something came out of nowhere. And I saw one of the forerunners or one of the ambassadors of atheism, Richard Dawkins, in an interview. And he was trying to explain to people, he was sitting in front of an audience, and he was trying to explain to them that this universe came from nothing. And he said something to the effect that the universe actually, it came from nothing. And then he said, I know this sounds ridiculous because, you know, in physics, we know that nothing comes out of nothing. You can't just be sitting one day and bang, something happens. It just doesn't work like this. There has to be a cause and effect. A cause has to be there. So he said, the universe came from nothing. And then he said, but this nothing is actually something. And then the whole audience started laughing. And he said, why are you laughing? And he was so offended by that because people found it ridiculous what he was saying.
Yes, so, you can quickly respond to
you
that.
You can dispute exactly what's meant by nothing, but whatever it is, it's very, very simple. And why is that funny?
Well, I think it's a bit funny to be trying to define nothing.
That this nothing is actually something. So then it didn't come from nothing then. Because that's what he's trying to say. SubhanAllah.